课培育之外，还将支持更多重大展览项目。我们愿与所有艺术实践者同行，与时代共进，为共享艺术建设新成果，助力新时代艺术文化的大发展、大繁荣而不懈努力。最后，我谨代表卢子老教、国教1573，祝愿本次活动圆满成功。谢谢大家。
再次感谢泸州老教集团。下面我宣布2023年重庆艺术大市场开放的6月四川美术学院艺术游活动开幕，请朋友们观看开场特别节目《美术馆之夜》。
非常绚烂的一个开场，亲爱的朋友们，这场以遇见阳光为主题的光影秀由四川美术学院照明艺术研究所创作并演出，采用光影艺术领域的前沿技术和理念，集结了诸多师生艺术家的创作实践成果。
Hello everyone.Welcome back to another episode of iChongqing's channel. This is Echo Chen, Ian.
And I am iChongqing reporter James. I'm very glad that you're joining us this evening.
So, as you can see, we are reporting the 2023 Blooming June special event night at the Museum, Art Museum, Public Aesthetic Education Week. It will be held from May 31 to June 3rd.Around the theme of Art Lights Up the City, Digital Empowers Art. This really fascinating event, including content of 3 sections. The first one is the cross-border visual show it will be held tonight, as you can see later. The second part of the aesthetic education open classes jointly launched by museums and schools from the evening of March 1st to 3rd. This is a really exciting event. With the theme of cross-boundary integration, art helps a better life. This graduation exhibition of Sichuan Fine Art Institute gathered 265 works of 294 graduates from the School of Public Art. You know, among them, 188 pieces of works were exhibited from Chongqing Contemporary Art Museum. 21 people have completed works with a score of 90 or more. And 15 were excellent works. I was really looking forward to see them. So are you going to visit the Blooming June exhibition, you know, this year?
You know, I would love to go and visit. Obviously, we're kind of a little bit busy. But in the past, I have attended this event before. So I remember back in 2020, 2021, I went to the Sichuan Fine Arts Institute in University City. Mm-hmm. You know, the location of the event has changed this year. I think it's in Huangzhouping, which is another fascinating part of the city because that's where you can find graffiti streets. So lots of, you know, city urban artwork down there. So, you know, if you're in Chongqing or, you know, you're interested in the city, that's somewhere I recommend you go and check out. But like I said, 2-3 years ago, I went to the Sichuan Fine Arts Institute to see this Blooming June event. And really, I had an opportunity to go and have a look around before the public was allowed in. And yeah, I was very amazed at a lot of the artwork they had there because the pieces they had were very innovative. And these are definitely pieces you wouldn't normally find in an art exhibition. Often they'll make things like, personal accessories, lots of handbags and things like that, but they're very
dedicated.
They're decorated in very special ways, and they also have lots of things that are kind of stuck on them. And of course, if you go to the Fine Arts Institute, I think a lot of people studying these courses are maybe ladies. So when I went there, there are lots of female orientated artifacts there, pieces of work. So yeah, it was a really fun and fascinating experience to go there.
Of course, the Sichuan Fine Art Institute is always devoting the power of education, aesthetic education field. Also, they wanted to create a really, vibrant vibes for students to involve in the social lives. As you just mentioned, they create kind of a really fascinating, captivating, creative accessories. Also, these designs of the students' graduation works are really fascinating, but also they're really helpful in life. Yeah, and they adapted some characters from the districts, from the local culture. And that's the thing that this institute, the Art Institute, has been always doing and always training its students. So as we are watching the signals from the site, singers are performing right now. And
I mean, to build on the point you just mentioned, I think something that's also interesting about my last experience is that if you go to these exhibitions, it's not only about looking at them. Actually, a lot of the pieces are for public sale. Mm-hmm. And of course, depending on the standard of the work, you get different prices. So some of them are a little cheaper. Mm-hmm. When I last went to attend the events in University City, I did see some special things that were on sale for thousands of yuan. And I did hear that actually people travel from all over the country, Beijing and Shanghai, because there are arts lovers who really have a high opinion of the pieces of work made by these students. Mm-hmm. So often when the Blooming June event comes along, people will travel here from all over the country and they will snap up these pieces of artwork before anybody else has the chance. But the good news is, I think they only take them away once the event has come to an end. So if you're just an average member of the public, you can go there and you can spend, you know, hours, you know, looking at all of the pieces of art.
Yeah. And the good thing is we have a really special event just right now. You know, I think it will wait for like 15 days until the real exhibition event has been held, right? It's almost in the middle of the June, but right now it's just the end of May, and we are facing a really fascinating performance from this. Let's watch this one.
First things first, I'ma say all the words inside my head. I'm fired up and tired of the way that things have been. Oh, ooh, the way that things have been. Oh, ooh. Second thing, second, don't you tell me what you think that I can be. I'm the one at the sail, I'm the master of my sea. Oh, ooh, the master of my sea. Oh, ooh. I was broken from a young age, taking my soak into the masses, writing my poems for the few that look at me, took me, shook me, killing me, singing from heartache, from the pain, taking my message from the veins, speaking my lesson from the brain, seeing the beauty through the... Hey! You turned me up, believer! Believer!
I think it's a combination of a contemporary dancing and pop song.
Yeah, with also some traditional elements in there as well. And, you know, innovation has been a big theme over the past few years. 非常感谢我们优秀的舞蹈演员。
青年是我们的未来，传统则是我们的血脉。川剧是中国最古老、最具特色的戏曲剧种之一。
身上 opera performance.
Okay, and I was just about to say that a lot of traditional performances, particularly intangible cultural heritage. I mean, a big example that comes to my mind is the Mudong folk song, say from Banan district.
So maybe
the older inheritors, maybe they just perform the traditional side of it. But at the same time, you know, younger people, they have an issue in mind, and that is they want to kind of make it more popular among the young generations. So really to do that, they have to incorporate a lot of, you know, modern elements. So for example, with the Mudong folk song, which is very traditional, so a long time ago, you know, people would maybe sing and perform that when they work in the fields, maybe to give them extra motivation and maybe help them work in tandem. But these young inheritors I've seen in Banan district, what they do, they've kind of turned them into rap songs.
Yeah,
so they wear the traditional clothing, but they've changed the lyrics and performed them in a rap style. So I really love to see things like that. I think it's a really innovative idea.
That's really captivating. And that's just when we are waiting for the signal coming back, we can still, you know, dig in the details of this exhibition, the graduation project. You know, this year, the graduation project from the Public Art Institute covers two majors, public art and technology, and involves topics such as urban renewal, art intervention in cities, green life, intangible cultural heritage, and better life in Chongqing. Integration of light and art and drawing Chinese stories. I think that's a really huge field for this school, for the public art school. It just shows that the under background of the cross-border integration, the school of public art focuses on new era, new journey, and new Chongqing. and it uses rich and diverse final words to achieve the beautiful goal of Chongqing's high quality development and people's high quality life. It would absolutely bring out the serious thinking and active exploration in art field. This is a huge topic, but when we, you know, narrowed it down into specific topics like public arts in school in the Sichuan Fine Art Institute is always a really special school because they've been working for this city decoration, the lighting decoration, just like the background, you know, like the buildings, they will decorate their outside appearance. They will ask for help from the school. And it will also help some very much more architectures to improve their designs.
Sure, and I've had a bit of experience covering topics like that. So in the case of the light show, like the buildings, so if you, you know, one of the best ways to see them is if you take one of the two river cruises at the right time, then all of the skyscrapers, you know, the edifices have been turned into like electronic screens, and come nighttime, yeah, they have shows, light shows on that work in tandem. And yeah, I remember, you know, every now and then, maybe they want a new light performance, a new light show. So they will offer a tender. And I remember when I last covered it, you know, a lot of, you know, maybe art institutes and also, you know, private, you know, media companies, they can, you know, compete for these with bids. Yeah, and they can basically design their own art shows, and then like later, maybe the city authorities will choose the one they like the best. And, you know, when it comes to bringing art into the city as well, I mean, I have a lot of experience with this too. So, you know, urban renewal has been a big thing over the last couple of years. So, for example, in regional districts, we visited some renewed, you know, urban spaces, you know, residential areas. So only a few years ago, maybe they were kind of in a bad state because they were built a long time ago, maybe in the 60s or 70s. And I remember interviewing some of the residents there, and they said, you know, they, in the past, they didn't really like living there because it wasn't very attractive. Maybe it was a little dirty. But, you know, if you compare the photos from the past with the present, you know, you'd be amazed by the difference. And some of the places I've been to in regional districts, you know, you wouldn't believe that they are that old. Yeah, so, you know, they've been completely resurfaced. You know, they had people build these culture walls. There are lots of really, you know, beautiful, you know, colourful artwork, and all, I know, very clean. And they've had improved access to the main city areas. And, you know, there are more examples of this all across the city. So, you know, for me, you know, that's a very vivid example of how, like you said, you know, art has been brought into the city and improved, you know, people's quality of life.
Indeed. And while we are talking about the fine art, I think it's sometimes really abstract for common people that they are not so familiar with the arts and stuff. But, you know, the Sichuan Fine Art Institute is always being, you know, putting efforts on the education of people, of common people, for the aesthetic education, not just for students in school. I think that's the main thing for this exhibition events, you know, to ask people to allow people to interact in this event, interact in this graduation event, not just go see an exhibition, but also, you know, to experience the art themselves.
Okay, so you mean like popularization?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I remember in a long time in the past, and I've had experiences of this, maybe you go into like an arts museum, mm-hmm. and okay, you look at the pictures on the wall and you kind of think to yourself, okay, that looks nice, but you know, maybe you don't really understand what it's trying to tell you.
Yeah,
but you know, having lived in Chongqing so long, I mean, I can say from personal experience that there's been lots of, you know, artwork that has been added into public spaces. You know, it could be murals, it could be statues. You know, like statues, you know, it could be sculptures. Yeah, and also, you know, a lot of these art institutes, there are also a lot of academies as well that, you know, teach, you know, young children, mm-hmm. To improve their artistic skills. And, you know, they hold regular events in public. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I've seen this myself over the past few years, art has really been popularized. It's not really something you just see as an abstract thing in a museum anymore.
Yeah. Can I ask a quite personal question about being a parent?
Of course.
Do you have this kind of thing to ask your daughters to, to get this kind of education, aesthetic education?
I think it's very important. And fortunately, there are a lot of, schools and, private academies around, because unfortunately, I love art, but I'm only good at admiring it. I can't really create anything myself. I'm just kind of a stick man kind of guy. I think, particularly for, very young children, I think it's very important to retain their artistic, sense. If you like, because if you don't really, grasp this opportunity when they're maybe 5, 6, 7 years old and they go into a school system, and it doesn't matter which country it is, because there's so much emphasis placed on academic performance that other things, maybe sports and art, kind of get pushed to the wayside a little bit. Yeah, so even with my younger daughter, who's kind of a big teenager nowadays, when she was little, we also placed a lot of importance on her, kind of training her artistic skills. Yeah, and I think everywhere you go in the city, every street corner will have an art academy. And I take her along, and she has a really good time. She comes home, she shows me the artwork. And I think it's a really great thing. And if we can just keep them in that habit, I think that will benefit them in the long run, I think.
Yeah, of course. And it's always been an inspiration, art itself. And for people, and also as a really growing international city, Chongqing, and this city requires such kind of huge powers that has been put into this field to allow more people to get this kind of aesthetic education. So still no signal from the site, but we can still talk about it, about the exhibition. I've been reporting on this exhibition itself, in 2020 and 2021, I was on the site on the Luo Zhongli Art Museum, the Sichuan Fine Art Institute Art Museum, and I was exploring those words from booth to booth, and I was captivated by their works and by how creative and how they can be, so fabulous on, inspiring the audience in every aspect. Because this is also the thing that I wanted to deliver in this live stream, because the Sichuan Fine Art Institute, it always has been this kind of thing on this education idea or concept, that the students from this, the student that graduated from this school, from the institute, they can't just create arts, without the reality. They have to put in their thinking in this city and in their land and in the earth. And that's the thing. So that's why we can see a lot of local culture characters, features in their designs, in their words. Also, the concept, the ideas of how they create arts are really, 很接地气.
Very down to earth.
Down to earth. Yeah, that's the word. Really, they always connected their words and their arts and their inspirations with the, the rivers in our cities, with the mountains in our city, with the sustainable concept, the sustainable development thing, concept, with blending to their words. They have always bring in the really positive thinking in their words about this city, about how we can build this city. And that's the thing that I wanted to deliver.
Yeah, it's kind of the same point for me in a way that, in the past, a lot of artwork has been very abstract. But if you go to these exhibitions, it is very down to earth. So like I said, a lot of the pieces of artwork you can find could be fashion accessories. Yeah, well, you know, it could be like a photographic exhibition, mm-hmm. you know, with, you know, pictures of the city, mm-hmm. or other things that have, you know, traditional elements in there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so when you go to see these exhibitions like Blooming June, I think it's now very easy for the public in general to understand what they are looking at.
Yeah, yeah. So still, no signal and... Do we have any comments here? Because I know it's not a really available time for our Western audience right now, but also we are looking forward to you to watch our show tonight. This is James and me, and we are hosting the show to present to you this really huge event in Chongqing. We call it the Blooming June. The special event, Public Art Aesthetic Education Week. And tonight we are presenting to you this event. It's called the Night at the Art Museum. And there are lighting installations, the lighting shows, and also Sichuan opera performance, contemporary dancing performance with the intangible cultural heritage features. And this really fabulous show tonight with very vibrant vibes. And so watch our show, please, and stay tuned with us. Like and share, subscribe to our channel on YouTube, follow us on Facebook, on Twitter, and on Instagram. I know that the signal is not coming back right now, but we can still memorize some details or interesting parts of this exhibition. You know, last year, I think the last year, okay, we can share one of our, you know, most impressive works from the Blooming June.
Okay, so it's been about 2 or 3 years since I last went to the gallery myself. I've already talked about the handbags, and even though, of course, they're not accessories I would use, but, you know, I did appreciate, you know, the very innovative design of them. Mm-hmm. And they're not only, you know, painted. I've seen other ones as well that kind of use, you know, old style, maybe 1950s or 60s, you know, Chinese newspaper, mm-hmm. you know, editions, ah. kind of as the surface.
Oh.
Yeah, that really sticks out in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, then also, you know, they have a lot of things like interesting, like sculptures that you could place in your home as well.
Yeah.
So, you know, it could be, you know, very unusual things, maybe like, you know, very space age, like a spaceman or something like that. And they have other things that hang from the ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I think just because of the high level of innovation, like I said, lots of people will travel, especially to Chongqing,
yeah,
to take a look around and buy up, you know, whatever takes their interest.
Yeah, that would be really amazing to see a lot of people from the international cities or cities in China to travel here just for this event, for the exhibition. And for me, I think one of my most impressive memories of impressions of these works is from the printing school. Most of my friends that are graduated from the Sichuan Fine Art Institute, they were graduated from the oil painting school and the printing school. And they do this kind of painting in rocks, in woods, or in plastic nets. We call it silk net printing works. So I was putting my eye on these works really specifically, and I really focus on their work because I think the materials and the objects that they've been using in this kind of works are really amazing. They are using a lot of kind of materials to create art. So it's kind of like really complicated but also fascinating process to create arts in, you know, a silk. Yeah, so that's a multiple kinds of process kind of
creating arts thing, but I really like it. So they are really impressive, their words. Okay, these are coming back. I think one of the most astounding part of this show tonight is the lighting installation behind the screen.
But you know, I've been to other publicity events, you know, around Chongqing municipality. Mm-hmm. And yeah, when they have the opening ceremony, they always kind of make it into a big, you know, exciting show.
Yeah.
So even just watching it now at the moment, I kind of feel like I really want to be there on the scene to go and experience the atmosphere.
Yeah. Do you happen to have this memory of, you know, the lighting show in the new year? You know, we are hosting the lighting show in the end of this last
year. Yes, of course. That one. Yeah, that was a really good memory. And yeah. I think we had, I mean, where we were based, I mean, I know you were here in the studio, but I think we were at the former North Station of the Jialingjiang near the Jialing River Cableway Station.
Yeah.
So that was taken down maybe around 2011, mm-hmm. I give or take a year.
Yeah.
So of course, you know, we can't ride that anymore, but they kept the North Station.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's very well preserved and they use it for some public and private events.
Yeah.
But for the Chinese New Year, which I think was the eve of January the 22nd, mm-hmm. 2023, I think we had the best seats in town for the fireworks show.
Yeah.
So I was up there on the rooftop.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and we had lots of fantastic performances, you know, like the Chongqing Ballet. And then when that was over, you know, we had this amazing fireworks display, which we hadn't seen for so many years in Chongqing.
Yes, that was really
that was a fantastic light show. And of course, they had the drone performance on at the same time.
Yeah.
And also around that time, you know, I saw other events such as in Liangping. They have a lake there, which is called Shangui Lake.
Mm.
Yeah, and they also had a fantastic performance there. Mm. Yeah, as for other light shows, we've already talked about the skyscrapers in Chongqing, but there were some other ones as well. I mean, if you take the Three Gorges Yangtze Cruise, or if you have the opportunity to go to Wushan in the far northeast of Chongqing, they've developed like a night cruise. They can go all around the Bay Area. Yeah, and the whole city is kind of like a big light show screen now. And I think as the finishing touch, they actually take you into the Lesser Three Gorges,
mm-hmm.
which has amazing scenery, and they project a really good, you know, audio-visual light show onto the side of the canyon.
Mm.
Yeah, so if that's your thing, then really in Chongqing, we definitely have something for you.
Yes, and it actually became a really characteristic theme for Chongqing, the lighting. You know, Chongqing doesn't own much name on the worldwide, but as long as people getting know to the city, you can see the city has more for you to offer. The lighting has highlighting the city's, you know, the landscapes. I think that's the really important thing for us to understand the city. Okay, now they're performing. What's this? Okay, this is the walkway show.
Again, for me, the styles are very unique. I can't say I've really seen anything like this. Although, if you watch some of these big international, you know, catwalk shows, like big fashion shows in Paris, sometimes you see the models, you know, wearing these very exotic, you know, outfits. So it reminds me a lot of that, but maybe in a more artistic manner.
And these works are from this year's graduate students in the Sichuan Fine Art Institute, the design school. As you know, you can always find some really fresh and spicy idea from this graduated works. They're really bold.
the ideas and their design are really bold. They might be not really connected to the commercial market, really not that down to earth.
But yeah, I know what you mean. So you don't see people wearing these.
Yeah.
Going on the street, you know, when you go outside. But yeah. So in a way, it kind of makes me think of body art a little bit. You know, I've known about body painting for a long time. There's maybe, for me, it's like the variation of that. So I think maybe you want to look at this as more like artistic expression rather than a practical clothing that you would wear in everyday life.
Yeah, that's the thing of fashion or designing, you know. The designers and artists, they always work in the front area, in the cutting edge line of this industry. They design crazy things like that. And the other brands under this, you know, this tower, they can, you know, create things for common people like us, but they can get inspiration from the world. For example, this season, you know, the fashion, you know, if this is a brand releasing its really fresh series of design in this year or this season, you know, they adapted this kind of color and it became popular and it became really, you know, really popular, really trendy this season, and it will infect all the brands in the world. And that's the thing, that's the fun thing about this industry. Like this purple, this color, then they are not just designed from nowhere. They always have this inspiration in the history that can reach him back to the top that destination, the top designing of this industry. Okay, Kevin is coming up and saying hello to us. Hi. Okay.
So hello, Kevin James. Kevin.
Yeah.
So welcome to the show.
Yeah, and I'm gonna put a banner of the show to let you guys know what we are covering today.
From what I can see, I mean, I find these clothing lines very visually attractive. And it does remind me that, you know, there have been other like very innovative, you know, styles in the past. So for example, I remember a few years ago in China, there was a dress that was made from maybe fish bones or something like that. Mm-hmm. And it was very popular, you know, internationally. Then of course, you know, I'm from England, that's what you can hear from my accent, of course. And that, I think, was it in England or was it the USA? I mean, you can go to a museum and they have these clothes and pieces of cloth that are made from spider silk, as well. So they're kind of made from over like a million spider catchers from Africa and Madagascar. So it's really amazing the things you can do, whether it's normal artwork or it's fashion. So this is a subject that really fascinates me.
Yeah.
Even though I have no talent when it comes to art myself.
No, it's not about the talent, it's about you have the interest on getting to know this industry or what. If you, I believe as a journalist, if you have the access for you to, you know, get an interview or talk with somebody in this industry, you'll be interested in that. Maybe for 10 minutes, maybe you can get more details of this. Beyond your imagination.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I've got some interesting, you know, international artists in Chongqing. They sometimes hold, you know, galleries in the city. So I've met some from Hungary, from Switzerland. Yeah, and all of them have their own very unique styles. If I give you an example, just a few weeks ago, last month, I went to a gallery in Chongqing, and it was made by a Swiss gentleman. And I thought his artwork was very unique because he had photographs of, you know, Chongqing, particularly night views. But his speciality is mixing acrylic paints. Yeah, so he kind of puts them either on the top or the bottom of the painting, and without mixing too much. I mean, if it mixes in a bad way, sometimes it gets some bad colors, but not in his case. He just kind of, you know, maybe puts it at an angle, and these acrylic, you know, colors kind of flow down, you know, into towards the middle of the painting. So, you know, you have this, you know, photograph of, you know, a Chongqing art view blended with these acrylic colors, and yeah, they really combine the very fantastic effect.
That was amazing. These are really, really, really erotic. You can see the adapted, the.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose. In my impression only, I mean, you know, the guy at the back, he kind of reminds me of some kind of sea creature, like a sea urchin or something.
Mm-hmm. They adapted some local materials like the bamboo, like those fabrics. I believe they are from the local culture areas like Rongchang. Yeah, do you happen to remember you've been producing shows in Rongchang?
Yes, been to Rongchang many times. Yes, the rummy cloth. And actually, they have the main company over there. And I remember in 2020, actually met the owner of the store, and actually, the man who founded the rummy cloth industry in Rongchang. Yeah, I've actually had the opportunity to meet him. And he has a very fascinating story. So, like in the little, it's quite big, you know, the sales center they have there in Rongchang. But it also acts as a kind of a museum. And I remember he showed me this contraption that was all made from wood. And they used it in the 80s and the 90s last century. And basically, it's a way to kind of weave the rummy cloth into maybe clothing or cloth. And, you know, it's really quite ingenious, but it's very labor intensive. And so it's very, I mean, it looks very simple, but it's very difficult to actually operate yourself. So basically, you push with your feet, so it kind of moves it, and then you kind of string. And you have like the thread, which is attached to like a piece of, it's kind of like a piece of jade, like a very smooth piece of rock. Yeah, so you kind of put it through, then you release your feet and it comes back down. And that way you can kind of weave a piece of cloth together. And that's kind of how the industry started. And he was telling me that, you know, over the decades, you know, a lot of people from, you know, particularly Korea and Japan, and in addition to China, of course, and they really like to buy this cloth. And they also, as part of, you know, innovation, they also traveled to South Korea in recent years, because, you know, Korea is also very famous for their cloth dyes. So they went there and they learned a lot of their dyeing techniques, and they came back and incorporated it into their rummy cloth industry. So now you not only have things like amazing clothes that you can buy there, but also other things like, you know, accessories and also toys like teddy bears and things like that. So if you go there, it's really a fascinating experience.
We also bring kids in this stage into the rap. And it's quite inspiring because they choose dancers, you know, behind the stage and also with the really techno music. Yeah, the music is really techno, and also the light installation in the screen.
I know what you mean. It's very visually stimulating. And also, you know, lots of the audio effects in there. So, yeah, you have the dance, you have the light show, you have the costumes, you have the music in there. Yeah, so they really, you know, combined all of these elements and makes for a fun and fascinating show.
Well, imagine if I have a kid, I would definitely, you know, ask them to dress like that. It's so cute. Like,
almost really poor installation, not a cloth, not a piece of cloth. But it is a costume. Melt into me. I am totally aware of their, you know, future scientific concept of this series. You know, they put on so much, you know, really, you know, like triangle thing in their designing, and also the silver.
And also with moving parts.
Moving
as
parts
well.
And the really architectural designing, the clothing, and it's really future.
Very
futuristic.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, it has a very futuristic space age feel to it.
Yeah. That's the main thing of the society right now these days. Like this one. This one seems so wearable.
Yeah, maybe I could imagine somebody wearing that at maybe a special event, like a ball or a banquet or something. That's possible.
Yeah. Wow.
And of course, there are lots of, you know, fashions that are becoming popular, especially a lot of these retro styles. Yes, yeah, so especially maybe like Tang Dynasty, like dresses and things like that.
Yeah.
Actually, my younger daughter really loves wearing those. When she goes to the nursery, my younger one, yeah, she likes to wear those like every day, unless, you know, they stipulate that they've got to wear the uniform that particular day.
That's important for kids to enhance their confidence, I mean, to choose their favorite costume and style. For me, it was really a way for me to enhance my confidence when I was a kid. I was always aware of what I'm going to wear today, how I'm going to build my personal style in front of everybody, especially in front of myself. That's the way of me of building my confidence. But that's the thing about design. So I think your daughter definitely has the sense. Yeah.
She certainly does. I suppose, you know, looking back, I mean, I grew up in the 80s and 90s. And, you know, there were so many things I know I could have done then that I kind of wish I had tried. So I remember at that time it wasn't, you know, just like the things like, you know, dance or the artistic clothing. It just, you know, at least where I came from, it wasn't really kind of the thing to do. But yeah, there were like, I do remember there were like a few people at the school who really stood out. I mean, some people had like the mohawk, you know, hairstyles, and, you know, some people did have their own special, you know, dresses and things like that. But I suppose like the only way I really kind of stood out in those years was, you know, I've always had a big passion for, you know, classical music and piano playing and things like that. But when it comes to other things like, you know, dance and, you know, trying other fashions and things like that, you know, I kind of wish I was a little bit more adventurous in those days.
Every generation. Melt into me. It is so to be. Makes sense to me. Rough body. Pour into me. Gelato. I'm so sticky. Melt into me. My melted body. Melt into me. My melted body.
Let me up. me, baby, let me come, let me drop, let me come, let me maybe, let me let me up, let me baby, let me come, let me drop, let me come, let me maybe, let me let me up, let me up. My mind, drop, come, my mind, body, let me up, my mouth, body, so I'm so sticky. My mouth, body, so mouth, melt into me. It is so goopy. Mix into me. Rub body. Pour into me. Gelato. Goopy gloopy. Drip drip dripping all down me. Like honey, I'm so sticky. Melt into me. My melted body. Melt into me. My melted body.
Okay,
so the lady is hosting the show. Let us see, is there any comments? Okay, still Kevin's here. Jeffrey, hi. Seems like a new friend. Industrial discotic structured.
Industrial discotheque structured. Yes, I know.
What do you mean? What's the meaning? What's the meaning of this word?
Well, we know like industry, so it kind of looks like something you might see out of a factory or something, like some of those costumes, like very exotic. Mm-hmm. Of course, I like disco, just like a discotheque.
Oh, discotheque. Yeah,
so like the original word for disco is discotheque.
Okay.
Yeah, so the old traditional discotheque with the spinning ball at the top.
Yeah,
so you
know
if you look
70s.
At the if you look at the costumes, the outfits we've seen in that fashion show and lots of those remind me of that, you know, very colourful, very extravagant. Mm.
Okay, what's next? Thank you.
I don't understand. Is it just a show?
I think so. I can't see any models on the stage.
Yeah, I can't see any images. Maybe it's just a contemporary time for. Or maybe it's this light show. Like this one, I can see.
Sure, yeah. Or could be just a grand opening to the next stage of the event.
Maybe it's the end of the show already. The main content of tonight is the runway show and the traditional performances. Also the light show. I think it's amazing to build such a huge stage in Huangzhuepin. It was an old area, like.
It is, and it's been very nicely renewed.
Yeah. Right
down there. And like I said, you can find graffiti streets down there. So there's a lot of graffiti walls.
Yeah, they actually held a lighting show, including the graffiti work. Artists from all over the world this year in March. Okay, they are done. What do you think of the show as an opening night for the Blooming June?
Yeah, it looks, from what I can see on the screen here, no, it looks a lot of fun. I mean, I suppose if you were there in attendance of the event, then it would have been even better. I mean, it looked very exciting. Lots of, fascinating costumes, lots of, audio-visual effects. Yeah, and I think, for the Blooming June event, this is like a really grand way to open everything up and, gain a lot of public attention. So it's been a lot of fun really to watch this over the past hour.
Yeah, the June has always been a graduation month in every year. And Chongqing has made this month an artistic one to let you know that this city is more arts in it for you to explore, and that's really fascinating for everyone. So thank you guys for joining us tonight. Thank you, Kevin. Yeah, it's really intriguing.
Thank you, Kevin. Great having you.
Thank you guys, and also Jeffrey, and also everybody who watch our show tonight. Thank you. Please subscribe us, and also thank you, James.
Oh, it's been a real pleasure. I mean, I don't often get to sit with you here on this table, so I hope we can do this more in the future. And of course, it's been a pleasure seeing everybody in our show tonight.
Thank you, guys. And thank you, Kai Long and Yilin, for helping us building the platform, really successful show. And thank you, Alex. There has been some connecting issues in the beginning of the show, and Alex is really care about this problem, and he has been helping on fixing that. And thank you, guys. So good night today, and thank you. Bye.
Yes, it's getting late here in Chongqing. So from us, it is good night. See you next time.
See ya.